into the other room.
Yeah, I got a good crowd.
You're almost like the board's liaison to the nonprofit world.
Hey, Nydia.
I don't know.
You know the yard work and all that.
I read it. You know my name in vain again.
The man with the check.
They identified it as one of the sore ones.
Yeah, but we have places we can look. But we have not done that yet.
And I've kind of gone there.
Thank you for this beautiful day. Please guide this commission and ever rule or all, just guide us to make proper things for our county. And thank you, Lord, for taking care of the people in Boston that was grievously harmed, and those people in Texas with the explosion, especially the first responders that all got killed or injured in Texas. We look to do the work in your name. Please, Lord, amen.
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 Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Are there any changes to the agenda today?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to move that we postpone item number 14.
Any date there, Commissioner?
That would be May 7th, please.
May 7th, board.
May 7th, board, please.
Second.
We'll just start ready again.
Can you just get that with me?
Item
14.
I wish that we're ready, but I guess not.
There's a motion and a second to move item 14 to May 7th work session. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? I forgot to announce Commissioner Levin is absent today. We'll be absent during the entire meeting, so we will not announce that the vote is 4-0 with him missing. He will not be here. Vote 4-0, passes. Any other changes to our agenda?
Mr. Chairman, I have one that I would like the board to consider. This would be agenda item, at least in the marked agenda, item 19. This would be Park and Rec bond funding. Myself and Mr. Gruen may need some guidance with respect to, particularly as it relates to this IGA we're talking about approving tonight or this afternoon. We'd like some guidance, and that will require a unanimous vote to put that on the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Have a motion second to add item 19, Park and Rec bond. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 4-0.
Thank you.
Thank you, Counselor. Any other changes? The motion to adopt the agenda as amended.
Second.
Have a motion second to adopt the agenda. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 4-0. Item 4, out of consideration and discussion. Number 1, approval of budget resolution. Director of Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. So I can draw the commission's attention to a packet of additional information we did hand out earlier today. You may not have had a chance to see it yet, but it was a one-page narrative in the top with a number of colored charts and graphs and so on. Not going to walk through all that, but just want to make a few comments about this. It's becoming an increasingly important item, and it's probably reflected in the dollar amount as well. Just briefly, we began in IS&T last year, budget time, we began to increasingly see the need for more sands or storage space, if you will, for the various areas of our technology across the county and all the areas, including areas such as Sheriff's Office, Judicial, Finance, GIS, and so on, planning. At that time, we had budgeted $100,000 for expanding our capability and some changes in the technology that have come along. Since then, we begin to see a rather strong trend eating up a lot more memory and needing a lot more storage space. And indeed, even each day as we're monitoring this and still getting our hands around the entire issue so that going forward, we can give the very best solution. But at this point, what we do know is that we need to ask for, and this item is for the funding, this will still go through procurement and the purchase will come back to the board, but we're requesting additional $76,000 in funding to be added to the $100,000. Funds are available within the IS&T fund, this is not general fund dollars, but it's to expand this storage capability. I can, if you have just the first page of the, to summarize what we're looking at here with the three pie charts on it, on our two sites, as far as our tier one storage is concerned, that's the storage that the applications go to retrieve documents and data that they need for their work. And at the bottom of the page, we show our admin site, which is here in this building in the server room. We have 40, that's terabytes over there, right? The TV is terabytes. And over the PSC site, which is both tier one, and we have replications and backup storage here, there's 78. With the additional amounts, we're planning to add to those two in the second section there, and we'll go through all the numbers, and having to remove some equipment that's running out to the end of its life. What we'll end up with is at the bottom of the page in red that the admin site will increase our capacity to 91.6 terabytes from the 40 we have now, so more than double that, and the public service site from 78 terabytes up to 107. So that's what this will do, what we expect this will do for us initially here. But again, this is an ongoing thing. We're looking at this. We're going to have to come back probably and talk a lot of different areas, come back with a well-formulated policy for how we do retention, how we manage this. Just there's a lot of, as we mentioned this cover page, we're doing such a good job of getting things more digital than paper. We're doing it so well, and with video as well, and other pictures and so on. It's just, I'll use the word almost at this point, last few weeks, almost an alarming rate it's using up memory. So we've really got to address this, but we need this initially to make sure we're ahead of the curve. If there's any other questions, with Wally and Brian are here to help the more technical aspects of this.
When we, it says in here somewhere that this is due to software platforms being implemented, and I guess my question is, who's in charge of deciding new software and applications, and when and if they buy that stuff, it ought to be included as part of the RFP, some way to project your storage area network requirements by adding N number of users using XYZ application or XYZ software. I would hope that's the case on an ongoing basis.
That's what we're looking at, is yes, the implications of these large software, I mean, the new finance software, we're going to be attaching documents, judicial's now attaching documents, the videos from the patrol cars now coming on being stored. I think, yeah, we're just beginning now to see the implications of these large applications and trying to get our hands around that, but we'd agree it's a good point.
You know, at some point, too, somebody's going to have to say, in so doing this, what is it we're saving?
Yes, yes. And again, just kind of dovetailing what you're saying, the idea is, of all the users across the county, in various departments and offices, how their operations are working, what they're saying, there's a cost to this. This is what we're seeing right here, is the cost to providing all this technology and storage. And that's what we need to do.
And is this stuff all redundant, or is it RAID, or some other form of redundancy? When you get this much stuff going, the idea of a failure is not something you want to contemplate.
So that's the example to the graph you had up that was the second page. So this is primary tier one storage, but these talk and replicate to the secondary site, which is mirrored. This is also tier one, since it's all a virtual site, all replicates real time.
Our disaster DR program, our disaster recovery is also being considered in this.
Would this?
Yeah. One that's on.
Will this storage be, I mean, are you seeing this as being enough to just for this year, or do you see it being enough?
It changes.
What's happened last year, early on last year, after the budget process was over and after we made the estimates on what we needed, some very positive things happened from the perspective of end users. They began using the Odyssey system more extensively to scan data and attach those documents to the records, which is a very, very strong process. I believe the sheriff's office added some cars and the video. The imaging that we store, which is the vast majority of this growth, I think, is an area of imaging, and can't compress it. That's one problem. So those two policy changes alone, along with bits and pieces in other places, dramatically increased, as you see from the charts, how much the disk utilization has gone up in the last 12 months, beginning with February 2012.
As of today, we see about 118 gigs of new data daily. So about 1% of our overall storage capacity created on a daily.
We want to have an answer to that question coming in today, saying, well, if we do this, it'll last 1 year, 2 year, 3 years. We're not that confidence level yet where we've got all the information to say, because we do need to know that. I know this will get us so far out, but it's hard to pin it how long.
To address this, we haven't been principal or even really heavily involved in the individual department budget planning meetings. And we feel like that we really need to for this reason, so that we know what the policy changes are going to be and practices are going to change, so we can plan for it. Otherwise, we're blind to it.
How long do we typically store this material? Is it a date we delete it all, or does it store
well, the current policy is basically we keep, obviously there's governmental policies on minimums, but there are no maximums. So we fundamentally keep everything, unless you delete the data yourself, it's kept indefinitely.
And that's one issue we're trying to address with the ITG, with the Governance Council. We're starting to look at this issue. How long it keeps, not just the minimum, but how long.
Yeah.
So, and then,
of course, we don't control content. We shouldn't control content. We just provide the place to put it. But yeah, as long as we maintain the keep it forever type philosophy, it'll continue to grow and grow and grow.
By the way, before I forget it, this is becoming more critical. When I wrote this up, I checked, not time sensitive, but should the board support this with a motion, we would like to change it to being time sensitive. We need to get on the purchasing procurement side of this as quickly as we can.
Is the other $76,000 coming out of that? IST fund?
Out of that fund, correct. There's funds available there.
Funds available there.
You know, the other thing, and there may be a reason for this, but we've got in very round numbers, so 20% increase in the amount of capacity that was initially called for, it appears, but that's costing us 76% of the previous cost, so it's also not a linear relationship between the capacity and the dollars.
It's not. A lot of it's technology based upon the level of sand we're having to go to. Early on with the budgetary predictions that we made, we were at a lower tiered sand, but based upon the data growth, where it was going, how it was getting utilized, we had to move to a higher tier technology, a higher level sand, if you will, more of your enterprise level sands, which inherently just run at a higher dollar value.
Any other questions?
Who is and when will we have a definable and agreed upon set of dates in which we will be deleting stuff rather than saving it, because it's costing us to not have a policy?
I'll take first counsel and get back to the board with a policy. We've submitted recommendations, but again, it's in every office and unit would have to have a particular set of requirements individually. We can help administer that, but
well, we set reasonable toward the end of this year. Do you think we'll have a lot of the input?
It's hard to pin a date on, but this is a really important priority.
It's going to require departmental inputs and quite a bit of time to lay down each particular area. But yeah, we need to do that. We need to do it as soon as possible.
There needs to be something done, because more slated, more cost.
Yeah. Right.
And give, I want to give IS&T and Brian and Wally credit. They have submitted some draft policies in the past, and what we have done is, and what we do today is, we comply with the retention policy or guidance that the states provide us. We've gotten that information out several times to all the departments and directors to comply the best they can with those retention guidelines, if you will. We don't know if they're doing that. It's cumbersome to go through that. It's cumbersome to look at each email, for instance, or each document and decide whether you save it 1 year, 3 years, or indefinitely. So I think for the most part, a lot of users typically will save that document and just forget about it. So we've got to get to a point where the end user, is the one that makes decisions about how long to save it and which file to dump it into and how long it's saved. But we will continue to work on those policies. And I think to have something drafted by the end of this year is probably reasonable.
I think our regular IT policy is about ready to come forward, but we need to know to have this included in there, so I'm trying to make sure.
And a lot of it's practice too. Outside of policy and everything else, a lot of it's the daily use of the network, instructing departments and users on how to do things. One of the big ones, I mean, not singling them out, but like with the sheriff's office, with video, being that it's such a key component of what they do, and analyzing it for accidents and things of that nature, three or four people or five people may have a copy of that video. So they all take that video that's 2 gig, 3 gig, 4 gig in size, they store it on their profile. So now you've taken that one video and quadrupled it. So now we're storing it five separate times. So, you know, it's a matter of helping and working with those departments on streamlining the ease and ways of being more efficient with the network, at the same time making sure everybody has the ability to do their job when they need to do it. So that's one of the biggest components. Sharing all that data is a mess. And it's not just that. I mean, I send one, I take a Word document, send it to all department heads. Well, now I've just sent that out to 35 different people, and it may only be a 4 meg file, but then take that action and multiply it 50 times in a week, start doing the math. I mean, you've got data growth.
Yeah, but that's the thing that I want.
No, exactly. You're absolutely right. But it's a domino effect.
Mm-hmm. Do you look at how other counties
store? Oh yeah, absolutely. Wally and I are both part of GMIS, and we're in constant communication with everybody on those boards, and we go to conferences twice a year, and we talk about these topics. and we come up with best use scenarios, best case scenarios, best practices, things of that nature, and a lot of it's very helpful.
Any other questions? Do we have a motion from the board?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion that we approve the IS&T Department request for additional funding to expand and upgrade the data storage system to meet the rapidly accelerating storage needs and to add an amount not to exceed $76,000 from available IS&T fund balance to the $100,000 now on in the approved budget.
Time sensitive.
Thank you.
We have a motion and a second for a time sensitive item number one. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 4-0. Item two, annual lease agreement between Forsyth County and the Georgia Department of Health Services.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, members of the board.
Yes.
Item number two is for your approval. A lease agreement that has with the Department of Family and Children for their existing facility, which is approximately 9,600 square feet. This agreement, this is the third year that there was absolutely no change in the terms. It is $9.77 a square foot and brings to the county $94,500 in income. This is a, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Clark. Any questions from the board? Lease agreement? Do I hear a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion that we approve the annual lease agreement between Forsyth County and the Georgia Department of Human Services, Division of Family and Children's Services, for office space located at 426 Canton Highway in an amount not to exceed $24,500.
Second.
Is the lease for 1 year?
Yes, it is.
Have a motion and a second for the approval of the lease. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 4-0. Number three, Sheriff's Office to approve the Sheriff's Office to apply to the U.S. Department of Justice for Bulletproof Vest Partnership Grant.
Yes, good afternoon, Chairman, members of the board. Item three is a request for approval for Sheriff's Office to apply to the U.S. Department of Justice FY 2013-2014 Bulletproof Vest Partnership Grant Program for an amount not to exceed $41,760 with a required match of up to $41,760. This grant program will help hopefully provide funding to offset the county's Bulletproof Vest purchases for new officers and replacement vests for the county. I believe I think it's 116 vests, and those are vests that are already in the county's budget. And this grant's a little unusual in that it helps offset our budgeted costs already. It's not something that we have to purchase new on our own. Grant funds for the match are available in the 2013 budget and to be part of the 2014 budget. Sheriff's request. Item is not time sensitive.
Is this the grant we've had before, or is this first year of this?
We had the grant prior to 2010, at which point in time the federal government put a mandate requirement on the grant program that there was a mandated wear policy for the officers. This year, I believe the sheriff has worked on and instituted a policy for. I believe it's officers that are on duty.
I can speak to that, Mr. Chairman, if you'd like to.
Please, sir.
The grant required that we change our policy. We did not have a mandatory wear policy, which means our officers had a choice whether to wear it or not. We changed the policy, they had no choice. We wear the vest. That's what made us eligible for the grant.
That's good.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
How many vests is this for?
Do officers swap vests during
$400 a
week? They expire. They have expiration dates.
I mean, but like, does one kid keep the one vest the entire time? Does he swap it out between officers when they come on duty?
No, it's fitted directly to each officer.
Fitted directly to each officer. Okay. Any other questions? Is that a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion. We approve the sheriff for the sheriff's office to apply to the U.S. Department of Justice FY 2013/2014. Bulletproof Best Partnership Grant Program in an amount not to exceed $41,760 with the required match in an amount not to exceed $41,760.
Second. Have a motion and a second for approval of item three for the grant for the Bulletproof Best Partnership Grant Program. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 4-0. Item four, request release budgeted amount for purchase of 13 bus chargers. This is a time sensitive item.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. We are requesting this to be time sensitive due to the delivery time on the vehicles. We are asking to purchase 13 of the Dodge Charger Pursuit vehicles from Atkins Ford Dodge Jeep. They do hold the state contract on this. It is a requirement, though, that since these are capital funds, that the board has to release the funding for us to move forward on this. The total purchase price would be $313,212.52.
Is this for growth, or what are happening to what I would assume the other 13 cars?
These are replacement vehicles.
What happens to the old ones?
The old ones? Sheriff, would you like to respond to that, or would you like me to? Some of them will be decommissioned because of their age.
Would they be auctioned off in the county sale? Yes. For the sheriff's department, mm-hmm. Or county fleet.
And none of these 13 can undergo that renovation program?
Refurbishing. Yeah. We'll probably be coming back later on for some other vehicles if they've determined to be refurbished, but these do not meet that criteria, sir.
They're too far gone.
Yeah. Well, they're a different model. They're Dodge Chargers. We're refurbing the Crown Vic.
Oh, okay.
It's Ford has that refurbished, or actually the dealership for Ford's have the refurbishing program.
So, I mean, on an ongoing basis, it begs the question why we wouldn't get Crown Vic so we could refurbish them.
We don't make them anymore.
Crown Vic's they stopped making. They've stopped a couple times in the past. That's actually the preferred police car. They don't make Crown Vic's anymore. Ford, in partnership with the dealerships, has started refurbishing them. They restore them. Virtually all the frame and the body, paint and everything to the new car. It's a good program. We're going to do that with as many Crown Vics as we can, especially for the taller officers. We can't even put them in these new ones. Corporal Starr is 6'6". He can't fit in anything but a Crown Vic. But they're also very competitive. So we're going to do that. We're not done with the Crown Vic refurbishing. We're going to do that with absolutely every one of them we can. So we're cutting down greatly on the number of new vehicles right now.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
There's a reason for everything.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions from the board? You'll hear a motion on item four.
Chairman, I'd like to make a motion that we authorize the request to release budgeted funds for the purchase of 13 Dodge Chargers to the Sheriff's Office in an amount not to exceed $313,212.52 for 13 Dodge Chargers from Atkins Ford Dodge Jeep Chrysler.
Time sensitive. We have a motion and a second to release the budget funds for the 13 charter. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 4-0.
Thank you.
Item 5, the authorization to enter into the agreement for Bytronics for the DigTrack.com one-call ticket management system.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. This is an agreement to go with Bytronics. It has been reviewed by legal, and that's why it's coming to the board. It is an agreement. It's for a cost of $4,200. Basically, what this does is allows our water and sewer department to get the one call, they do their own utility locates, to get the utility locate information out in the field. Now it comes into their office. They have to print it out, distribute it the next morning. Now this software will allow them to get the tickets directly out in the field to really expedite their work and assist them with that. So we'd like to approve entering into the agreement with Bytronics for the DigTrack communication system with permission for the county manager to sign the document. Thank you.
Is this a one-time cost or just like a yearly maintenance cost or something?
It would be annual.
Annual cost?
Yeah.
It's based on the number of tickets.
And
we can be canceled at any time.
Not
pay anything up front. It's per call, per ticket charge. And this is an estimate. Estimated for the yearly amount, and those have increased drastically. I think we hit a day last week. We had 300 locate tickets called in one day. And what this software does, it helps you take the ones that you don't need to locate, and sort them based on a cable drop that's only 12 inches deep and you know it's going to sewer line. And so this helps you manage the calls and the tickets so we don't have to spend somebody in the office doing this. It just helps eliminate people get tickets, things like that.
What are the storage requirements?
It's on their server. I think this is on their end.
And really, actually, just so you know that when we do anything with IT, we ask them first before we bring it to you. We do.
Equipment requirements.
10
terabytes.
Does this go straight to the computer on the trucks while the guys in the field?
We have laptops in the field, and they'll be able to open and close their tickets from the field. You get the emergency tickets and things there. It'll link up with the state's one call system and bring the data in, change the format, just help us manage it.
Put it insurance on it if we do get a telephone line or something that's mismarked.
But it's all on us.
All on you. Any questions from the board? Hear your motion.
Chairman, I'd like to make a motion to authorize to enter into an agreement with Bytronics Inc. for the digtrack.com one-call ticket management system for the water department in an amount not to exceed $4,200.
Second. I have a motion and a second for the agreement for Bytronics. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 4-0. Item 6, request for approval to transfer price agreement for the purchase of aggregate Bluegrass material.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. The current plant that we have our agreement with Lafarge Aggregate in Forsyth County has been sold to Bluegrass Materials Company. We have a contract with a few different companies for the aggregate purchase, but when that happened, we do need to bring this back before you and say we would like to continue this agreement through calendar year 2013. With Bluegrass Materials. Bluegrass Materials has agreed to retain our pricing that we had with Lafarge for the calendar year. Thank you.
Does that need to be time sensitive?
No, sir. That'll be fine. Thank you.
Any questions?
Yes, Donna.
Yes, sir.
The note in the book says the amount requested will be based on need and is not to exceed budgeted amount. If we had a need that is vastly more than what we anticipate, are they forced to keep it at this price?
No, they keep it at the same price, but their budgeted amount, they would come back before the board and say we need more money.
Okay.
Similar to what the IS&T Department just did. All right.
Any other questions?
Yes,
sir. Do I hear a motion from the board?
Chairman, I'll make a motion that we accept the transfer pricing agreement from Lafarge Aggregate to Bluegrass Materials Company LLC for the budgeted amount of $93,600.
Second.
I have a motion and a second for approval of item 6. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 4-0. Item 7, award bid C13-16-LIBR for the HVAC replacements here in Fort Library.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. We are asking that this be a time-sensitive item due to the scheduling constraints for the library to use some of their state funding by the end of the summer, by the end of June. As you'll see, this is a little bit over the budgeted amount that we have available, but the library board has said they will cover that amount. We would like to award this to the qualified low bidder, which is QT Contracting, doing business as Powers Heating and Air, in the amount of $53,402. Thank you, sir.
How old is the other? Is the one that's there now?
There's four units. There's a total of five units. The first unit, the one component's going to be changed out. And I believe the library's here. They're
original building that was built in 2000.
Since 2000. And the other four units will be totally replaced. And I think one of them right now that doesn't. One of them currently.
One
just died on us during this process.
Any other questions from the board? We hear a motion.
Chairman, I move that we award bid C13-16-LIBR to QT Contracting Incorporated in business as Powers Heating and Air in the amount of $53,102 time sensitive.
Do we have to mention the budget amount in that request, or is this fine?
It's fine.
That's
fine.
I have a motion and second on time sensitive item number 7. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? carries. 4-0.
I applaud the library board testing the air conditioner while I was this cool.
Thank you.
Lucky.
Yeah. Item 8, the award of RFP to C13-15-315 engineering services for the Brookwood Caney Road sidewalk project.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. This was issued to the pre-qualified firms. We have 5 pre-qualified firms for engineering services. We asked them for their pricing and for their schedule to complete this. It is a SPLOST 6 project under traffic safety improvement. It's designing a sidewalk along Brookwood Road. The total project cost, including construction, is approximately $418,000. We're asking to award this proposal to Wolverton and Associates in the amount of $49,860. Just so you have a comparison, the other firms did provide pricing and scheduling. They were the low cost. These have been pre-qualified. The highest cost we had was $164,000. The approximate schedule is 11 weeks with Wolverton. The other folks submitted schedules in the approximate 20-week time period.
Any questions for the board for the SPLOST 6 project? Do we hear a motion from the board?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I would move that we accept the proposal or award the contract for the engineering work, accept the proposal from Wolverton Associates in the amount not to exceed $49,860. Does that need to be time sensitive?
No, sir.
Second.
Now, a motion and a second for the approval of item 8, the engineering services. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 4-0. Item 9, approval of right-of-way easement with Sony Electric for fire station number 3.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. You'll probably remember that the board did approve this originally, and that was wonderful. But we do have to have, for the sewer line that's at that property, we have to have a pump as well. And the pump is a bit of a distance from the actual fire station site. So Sawnee EMC is requiring an additional right-of-way easement agreement so that we can get the electrical to that pump. So this agreement is the one that legal has previously approved. There is no cost to us at this time, and we're just asking for approval. Thank you.
Donna, just a real quick question. Is there an Exhibit A? That you can lay your hands on?
I can.
Okay.
And I'll find it. I'll give it to you.
Why is this just not something that comes out of the water and sewer department?
It's a fire station.
It's a fire station.
It's not ours. This is part of the station, and not it's just for their facility.
It goes across our land, so we have to give it right away. Is that right, Don?
For the power.
It's just right away for the power. Yeah.
All right.
Thank you. Permission for them to be on our property.
Right.
Any other questions? Do we hear a motion for the board?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion that we approve the right of way easement for Sawnee Electric for fire station number 3.
Second.
Have a motion.
I'm sorry, we have it as time sensitive. We're in that construction phase right now. I apologize.
Yes, and my motion is time sensitive.
Second, time sensitive.
Thank you. Have a motion for approval for time sensitive item number 9, the Eastman Sony MC, Fire Station 3. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 4-0.
Thank you.
Thank you. Item 10, appointment of a member to the Social Service Committee to fill the unexpired term of Nicole. Director of Finance.
So, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, we now ready to bring forward to you a nominee to fill this vacancy on this committee. And that person is Niki, Collela, who is also replacing Nicole's position on the Community Connections organization. And this would be a great time to get this committee back up to full staffing as we're anticipating bringing the awarding of social services grants back into the budget process toward the end of the budget process. She's here.
You okay with this?
Yes.
You gonna come to all meetings? That's important.
That's important. Yes, sir.
Any questions from the board? Is there a motion from the board?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion to appoint to the Social Services Committee for the unexpired term Nicole Morgan, Ms. Nicole, Niki, Collela.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to appoint new members of Social Service Committee. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 4-0. Thank you. Thank you, Nick. Item 11. Update from South County List to recognize the training provider for the alcohol ordinance. Director, come to the
top. Mr. Chairman, members of the board, South County Alcohol Ordinance requires a mandated training program for applicants seeking a new alcohol license. The Board of Commissioners will also require training for certain outlets after following the violation.
Our current list has two companies, Endevi and TIRV, which stands for the Training Institute for Responsible Vendors. The item before you is a proposal to add Operation 21 to the list of qualified training providers. This is not an ordinance change, it's simply an action by the Board of Commissioners where I would leave and implement that change if it's approved.
Time sensitive?
Doesn't need to be time sensitive, no.
So we just basically added another vendor.
Right. Added another vendor. Yes.
Any questions from the board? Do we hear a motion from the board?
Chairman, I would move that we update the South County list of recognized training providers for the alcohol ordinance and add Operation 21 to the list.
Second.
Sorry.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 4-0.
Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Possible change, item 12, possible change to alcohol code to authorize microbreweries. Are you going to handle this, Counselor? Or?
Mr. Chairman, I will. It's Tuesday, which means we're talking about alcohol. I want to talk to you about a possible change to our alcohol code. This is something that we really, our alcohol code doesn't speak to at all, although our UDC does. Our UDC contemplates that we might have breweries in the county, but our alcohol code doesn't really anticipate breweries, or the agenda item before you today is microbreweries. Presumably, microbrewery simply is the manifestation of a limitation on the number of gallons of malt beverage or beer that would be produced at the brewery. We have had some interest in going forward and changing our alcohol code to at least authorize a license for microbreweries. I think the feedback that folks who wanted to do this sort of thing have gotten from the state is, why can't we do this in Forsyth County if we're otherwise meet zoning? And I think the state wants some sort of a license. And right now, you know, Tom's here, I don't think, Tom, you'd have a license to give them if someone came in to operate a brewery, because we don't really speak to it in our code. The interesting thing, and the verbiage that's in your agenda book is actually not verbiage that I came up with. I think it's actually verbiage that one of the stakeholders has provided, and it's not bad verbiage at all. I will tell you, though, that first page where it has like a definition of microbrewery, and then it contains like breakdowns of capacity, 15,000 barrels a year, 15 to 6 million barrels per year, over 6 million barrels per year. I don't know that you necessarily need that in your alcohol code, and let me explain. The way this is set up is that, first of all, this language you have in front of you, all of it, not just this first page, but the whole packet, anticipates that we would have a license for microbreweries. Okay, that's easy enough, fairly simple, $1,000 fee, you get a microbrewery license, and you would renew it every year. But then it speaks about sort of breaking down where you could put various breweries based upon the amount of gallons they produce in sort of a zoning framework. If you're zoned this way, you can go into commercial, and or if you're producing this number of barrels, you can go into commercial and light industrial zone. This many barrels goes into a heavy industrial zone. That, to me, I don't really want to get my alcohol code filled with a bunch of zoning stuff in it. First of all, it changes how we have to approve it. We got to follow the Zoning Procedures Act if you begin to do that. To me, if we're going to start breaking it down that way, that really needs to be in the UDC, if we're going to begin to break down where you can put different sorts of breweries based upon their output. So what I'm seeking from you today is first direction. Does the Board of Commissioners want me to put together, and this would be a very de minimis, not very lengthy, licensure for microbreweries in the alcohol code? That's real easy. and I can do that fairly quickly. But if you want to start talking about, you know, where can you put them, our UDC already provides where a brewery can go. But if you want to start breaking down, like a brewery that produces this much can go in these zones, but one that produces this much has to go elsewhere, that would take a UDC amendment, at least as I read the zoning code right now. Tom, is that fair enough?
I agree.
How would this apply to, say, microbreweries that want to locate next to restaurants that want to produce their own beer? Not 15,000, you know.
You know, if you say they want to locate next to restaurants, that's fine. But if you're talking about in a restaurant, like a brew pub, that wants to have a certain amount that they sell off-premise, now we already allow that.
Yeah.
This is talking about a brewery that does not sell food and does not allow you to take a six-pack off the grounds. This is talking about literally a small Budweiser plant. Yeah. Now, I'm not trying to be melodramatic. I mean, it probably would be a small sort of a craft.
But not located. You have to be located outside a restaurant, I think so.
That's right.
What you would need to proceed.
Well, if you want me to just get in place a microbrewery license, that's easy. I can go ahead and start running the legal ads, and we'll go ahead and get that licensure in front of you in a couple of months, and we can approve it, and then a microbrewery can come and make an application. But if you want us to somehow fool around with where they can go in the county based upon the specific volume of output of beverage they're going to produce, that's going to be a UDC modification. And quite frankly, unless you feel real strongly about that, if we want to just get this in place, my recommendation is let's just do the alcohol code modification and maybe leave the UDC modification for another day.
Well, so if we have a license for a microbrewery and a guy says, I'd like to get a license and I'm going to put it right next to a church over there, that'll be okay under current UDC?
Well, I mean, Tom, off the top of your head, do you know where we allow breweries? What zoning designations can have breweries in?
Heavy industrial with a conditional use permit.
Okay, and if we already allow breweries in the UDC, are you saying that we just don't license breweries?
That's right. So they go down to the state of Georgia to get their license as well. And the state of Georgia says, where's your Forsyth County brewery license? And they say, I don't have one because Forsyth County doesn't license them. And they say, well, Forsyth County needs to license them if you want to get one here.
This just gives us the ability to license a brewery, doesn't it? I mean, we're not changing, in your advice, we're not going to change UDC. We're just going to license brewery and stick with our UDC.
Does it allow tastings?
It would. It would allow free tastings.
In a closed off room.
But be mindful, you know, we don't have a ton of heavy industrial zone properties in the county, and it's going to require a water use permit even in that area.
That's correct.
So be ready. So as soon as we authorize this license, we may get a heavy industrial zoning application to come in, and then of course there'll be an associated cup coming in with it.
Could they apply for a variance to the zoning, Tom? Go through the variance appeal?
Not a variance to the use of the zoning. Yeah, if there is, I think it was Alpharetta recently made some changes to allow this type of small scale production in more of a retail commercial type atmosphere. The applicant who had contacted Commissioner Levent, as my understanding of what they were looking for. So we couldn't give them a variance to help them if we don't change the UDC. They're gonna have to go in that heavy industrial district.
So what you're saying, we're gonna wait and get an application for a microbrewery, and then we may have to change the UDC, if they can't fit where they want to go, then we look at the UDC.
And I think more than an application, I think it would just be continued feedback from potential business owners asking the board to consider a UDC change.
I think you could anticipate they're gonna say, let me in commercial with a cup.
Any questions for the board at this time? Well, do they need a motion to carry it on, Council?
Motion to go ahead and commence legal ads.
Will this culminate in a public hearing?
It will, it'll culminate in two, yes sir.
I'm not particularly against microbreweries. I'm not particularly for them. I'm sort of the guy whose name is on this, and so.
Sort of. I believe that does spell Bob. B-O-F-F.
I don't normally have a slash in front of my last name, but, so.
It's just one public hearing at this time.
Yeah.
I really would like to have some idea of, you know, what we thought this was going to do for the county in terms of tax or something, and I have no idea. I have to say, I think it's instructive that we have a place where you could have a brewery, and apparently the incidence of anybody asking for such is zero in how many, in years and years and years. And now we're going to set the world on fire with microbreweries, perhaps.
We may not, but the way I get the state says we need to kind of get on board with this. I mean,
well, I think the state simply is trying to honor localities and saying if this is activity is going to be allowed, the local county is going to have to provide a license for it.
We allow it now, we just don't have a license for it.
We allow it for land use. We allow it for land use.
We give them an occupational business license, which is nothing more than an occupational tax certificate in the state of Georgia, so that's not good enough to get a liquor license from the state of Georgia.
All right, so I will go ahead and make a motion that we ask the counselor to begin to write up change to the alcohol code to authorize microbreweries.
Do we hear a second?
Second.
Have a motion and a second to authorize a public hearing about microbreweries. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 4-0.
Thank you.
We're going to watch Commissioner being issued into that.
Yeah. Well, thank you.
Item 13, review and approval of the Lake Altoona Upper Etowah River Watershed Protection Plan.
Mr. Chairman, several years ago, we entered into a multi-party agreement with Cherokee County, Cobb County, Dawson County, Bartow County, and others to study the Upper Etowah River and to develop a watershed protection plan, and that we did a watershed analysis also. At the completion of that project now, the EPD has approved the draft plan. It includes some long-term commitments for South County, and therefore the board has to sign off on it. Renee and John are here. The Water and Sewer Department started this project because as water quality issues typically come back to water and sewer discharge and withdrawal permits, and that's how they get to us. But John's office manages the ongoing monitoring and water quality results. And most of the requirements in here were already things that have been completed by engineering or they have in their 2013-2012 budget. There were some minor changes. I believe Renee said they've already incorporated those into their budgets for the future. We moved sampling spots. We had a watershed plan approved back in 2000, and so we were already doing long-term monitoring, and all we did now is we've joined it as a group, and so the EPD will get the reports collectively with the other systems. It's just a better way to keep check of water quality. But Renee can answer any questions, and I'd asked her to be able to answer questions about any impacts to their budgets or long-term financial commitments. But by approving this, the EPD will then sign off on the plan once all the counties have approved it. This is something that would have to happen and you'd have to have in place before you pursue withdrawal permits, discharge permits out of the Etowah Basin. Be glad to try to answer any questions.
Has most other counties got their approval from the basin?
Other counties are in the process. You know, it's not a requirement. You just won't be included under the umbrella of this plan if you don't do it. And if you ask for something later, you'll be on your own. You'll probably start over, probably do a new assessment, new study. But it didn't affect us as much as it did some of the other counties directly on Lake Altoona and Cherokee County. Systems that have withdrawals and discharges in the river, but as they go out and study the waste level, the loadings, the phosphorus and nitrogen and things come from agricultural runoff and development runoff, and so it includes monitoring of all of that to go into a an assessment to help manage the resource.
So if we ever got a withdrawal permit from the Etowah, we'd have to have this in place.
Correct. And we already had one We already had one, but we were on our own. We weren't monitoring and reporting the same, doing the sampling the same way. And what we did, we joined in. We saw the benefit of doing this regionally as a group because the river doesn't know where the nitrogen comes from. It all ends up in Lake Allatoona in the river. And so it's just a better way to work together as a region to protect the water. And engineering was already doing long-term monitoring and ecological studies, whatever, 2 years, and that's the same here. We just moved the sampling.
Right. In our conversations with them when they were working on the plan, we were already monitoring a station on Sitting Down Creek at John Burris Road. They had selected a station very close to that. They agreed to shift the location so we could monitor one that was already in our plan. We picked up a new one on the Etowah River, Yellow Creek Road. And then some of the parameters that are monitored have changed. They've added some additional parameters. But we've already accounted for that and included it in our budget for 2014.
What does this cost? What's our budget now for?
Well, the difference in what we were already doing and what it would cost to add this was about $3,800.
That comes out of water and sewer?
No. It's in the environmental monitoring.
Oh, your coverage, John?
Stormwater budget.
Thank you.
He's a good guy.
Citizens, one way or the other. Any other questions? Do we hear a motion from the board?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion that we approve the Lake Allatoona Upper Etowah River Watershed Protection Plan. As outlined in our book and our discussion today.
Second.
Have a motion and a second for the approval of the Lake Allatoona Upper Etowah River Watershed Protection Plan. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 4-0. Item 14 has been postponed until May 7th, work session. Item 15, consideration of county initiated variance from Gilbert Grove Development owned by Sharp Residential. Pam's Mills. Which one?
I can give it a shot if you like.
Is it okay. Y'all's name or that slash mean something?
this project was zoned back in 2006, I believe, by Commissioner Ledbetter was the commissioner at that time. And it's a res for zoning. What has happened is the side yard buffers, I guess, as you would call them, the side yard setbacks, have changed. So although he doesn't have a vested situation because he can still build the same number of houses, he could build bigger houses if he had the old side yard setbacks, which I think helps us. So I believe he is here and he is willing to agree to build the bigger houses as required if we are willing to give him a variance to the side yard setbacks. Is that the way you understand it, Mr. Sharp?
That's correct.
How many square footage are we going from and to?
This currently minimum is 1,800, isn't it?
Currently at 1,800 and I'll voluntarily accept no smaller than 2,600.
Three-car garages or just regular two-car?
Maybe some three-car front and three-car side where it'll fit. Primarily, it'll be two-car front based on the lot width. But we can build larger houses and have more variance in the footprint size.
So it's the same number of houses that it's zoned for. We're not getting any more or less houses. We're just allowing for bigger ones. And we're able to actually condition bigger houses.
What about the fire code? The house is supposed to do.
We have a fire code for that. It tells us what we're supposed to do.
We've come up before.
But this will fall into it, doesn't it?
I'm sure they would apply to the codes.
Oh, yeah.
That's correct.
And this is really, hopefully, tangential, but it says somebody initially submitted a letter for a private sewer provider. Is this on septic or public sewer or private sewer?
It'll be on
Sure. It's the James Creek wastewater facility. It was private.
Yes. It was your district to the recent changes.
Will this be town?
Do you need to get rolling on this?
Preferably, yes, sir.
It won't matter, because even if it's not time sensitive, it'll still start the process going. We still have to have a public hearing. So
we still have to have a public hearing?
Yeah, even if it's ratified at a next regular meeting, that is already going to get started, which I'll do.
Sort of go on the consent agenda.
Any other questions from the board? Good presentation.
You have a motion? Yes.
Need screens, Brookwood?
Just about. Okay. Well, I don't know that I need to go through all these conditions at this time. We're just moving into.
No, 1.0806 just says the county initiated rezoning is fine. You just need to authorize placement of the legal ad. We'll take it from there.
My motion is then to authorize placement of the legal ad and move to start the process moving, which I guess would be to first available public hearing.
For a county initiated variance.
With respect to Sharp Residential. I don't see a zoning.
There's no zoning. Yep, good. Now, Sharp Residential.
Field of Road zoning as presented in our books. Is that adequate?
Yeah, just for the record, I mean, it's the Gilbert Road LLC, and this is more for Cindy. This is the 38-acre tract. Is that right?
Correct.
Yeah. That's sufficient.
Okay. I have our second.
Second.
I have a motion second for the county initiated variance for Gilbert Road development by Sharp Residential. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 4-0.
Public hearing will be at the Board of Commissioners level, right?
It will be.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
And what date?
Yeah.
We don't know yet. I mean, yeah, we'll have to.
Item 16.
So here run the ads.
Okay.
Sorry.
It's all right.
It'll be at a public hearing. Take action.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Item 16. Offer appropriate donation for parcels in Greenleaf subdivision. County Attorney, we postponed it one time.
We did, and Mr. Chairman, members of the board, I just wanted to give you a brief update rather than request that it be postponed. The tax commissioner is actually running and using the I think it's just a property title firm that he uses to run a comprehensive list of all the titles and ownerships for every parcel in Greenleaf. And he does not have that information available yet, but he will. And so we're just going to, I mean, I was going to respectfully delay bringing you anything formal until that is done, and then when I'm able to bring you something, I'll be able to tell you who owns all the parcels and if it's totally, you know, 60 different owners for each different lot, or whether a lot of them are owned by a common owner, and then that may help you give me some guidance on how you want me to approach it. You know, we've got individuals like that started this agenda item literally wanting to donate those parcels to the county. But just one or two individual isolated lots being donated to the county doesn't do the county any good, doesn't do, quite frankly, anybody any good, except, you know, messing up chain of title worse than it is already. Seems to me that if we can get you some information that shows who all owns all the various lots, and if maybe one common owner owns 30 or 20 of the lots, might help us be able to reach out and maybe even have some meetings with some of these property owners and see if there's anything we can do out there.
As Matthew said, is he starting a legal process for taxes?
He has started a legal process.
So that's just for general information.
It is, and that's why he's running the title searches, is that's part of his commencement of tax sales.
Is there a way to block off that?
You know, the tax commissioner used to have, John, check me on this, was it Matt or your office that used to have that subdivision blocked off with the fence?
I think we gated it on at his request.
I think we did too. I think we gated it at Matt's request. The problem was, is I seem to remember there was one home in there that you know, no one's living in it, obviously, but it was kind of kept up nicely, and so that was an issue as well in there, and so it does get to be a little bit of a problem, but I know what you're talking about. Yeah, I know.
I'm getting complaints by constituents that, I mean, the law went out 2 nights ago, and she thinks arrested people. I just wondered if we could block it off. She says there's horrible things going on. I just wondered if there was a way we could.
Now, I think when we blocked it off, those were county roads, or at least we thought they were, but now it's all private property. I guess at the tax commissioner's request, it could be gated off out on the right of way. And I thought about you had the key to it.
I thought he did too. In fact, I thought he, I don't know if the barricades are still up and just open, or whether he could close them. Do you know?
I was out there about a year ago, and there was a gate, but one side of the gate was taken down, or it was open, and you could freely drive in.
We already spent money one time cleaning that mess up out there. People dumping garbage in, I guess.
Well, I mean, I fully expect when I bring this back to you, the board may give me some instruction to try and see if we can't come up with a solution out there once and for all.
Thank you. Item 17. County payment of back taxes on property donated to county attorney.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. Let me pass this out to you. This came up on our agenda at the last work session. I actually asked that it get postponed. The resolution wasn't clear enough to me, and now it is clear. This is where we accepted a piece of right-of-way on McGinnis Ferry Road, and when we accepted it, we agreed to pay the county portion of back taxes. It was like in December of last year. Does this ring a bell to you all? All right, well, it's time now to pay the taxes on the property. And Matt's office, tax commissioner, asked that we pay the full freight of $2,019, and that's fine. But I want you to understand, because all the Board of Commissioners wanted to pay was whatever we had to pay that actually would go to the state. Right, because the state gets a portion of the taxes. Well, that's $989.07, and that's in the resolution. Forgive me, Doug, and Kim, and all y'all didn't get y'all.
State and school board?
Right. That's correct. So you may ask, well, then why are we asked to pay $2,019.95? Because that's what's on Matt's books, is what's outstanding. So if we pay him the $2,019.95, he'll send $989 to the school and to the state and take care of that, and literally the $1,030 we'll still get.
Yeah. If I may, though, it would keep our funds whole too, because the portion we get would go to general fund, debt service bonds, and fire, where I would expect the charges to the related project, which is another funding source.
That
would be a good clean way to do it.
I just wanted y'all comfortable that when you're paying the full 2019, just to understand that we're really not going to be, we'll be getting that money back. We'll only be literally netting out $989 or so.
Right.
And I do need this adopted.
How much land was it?
How much land did we get? Oh, goodness. John, do you remember off the top of your head the McGinnis Ferry donation we got?
That's the one.
About 7 tenths.
How much?
It's about 7 tenths of an acre.
7 tenths of an acre?
It was under an acre. Half.
Any other questions? Do you have a motion from the board?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I would move that we go ahead and pay the entire $2,019.95 in back property taxes for the tax parcel 090177. McGinnis Ferry Road.
Second. One question. There's no penalty interest on this, are there?
No.
We're going to adopt the resolution.
Adopt the resolution. It's not time sensitive, but I'll.
Yes, I move we adopt the resolution as presented by council.
Second. I have a motion and a second for the county payment of back taxes on property donated to county. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 4-0. Item 18, the IGA between Forsyth County and City Cumming related to the improvements of City Park, construction improvements for public parking facility. Abandoned certain municipal property for provisions of condemnation services.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, thank you for this. This is an IGA that we have discussed already at a work session, and in fact had approved already and sent to the City of Cumming. There still was some modifications. You may recall the city then tweaked it a little bit and sent it back to us, and then we had to tweak it further. So this is actually the version that the city has approved, but they've approved it with, I guess what I'd say, the county's modifications to it, but you will need to approve this again to make it an effective IGA. This is an IGA that does a couple things. All of it is linked fairly closely to the jail courthouse projects that we have ongoing downtown right now. If you go to page 3, the first element of the IGA is the condemnation element, and again, I don't want to get into the weeds of the value or the legal mechanics of the condemnation, because I don't want to give our position away with the property owner, but I will say the county may have to condemn the Pilgrim Square property that is to my left out the window that you can see, and that will be in, at least in part, for a parking deck or parking facility that is part of the jail courthouse project. So this simply memorializes in the IGA the fact that we'll be condemning within the city limits. We will receive city cooperation, and we will not obviously receive an objection from the city with respect to the condemnation action. It also provides that with respect to a public parking facility, that the city of Cumming is going to pay us $5.3 million. That is out of their SPLOS 6 funds. You may recall that out of SPLOS 6, the city of Cumming had a parking deck obligation. They are going to satisfy that obligation by paying us $5.3 million that we will then blend into our parking deck funds, and we will build these. Actually, we're going to build two parking decks. I know that everyone.
When will we receive that?
We will receive that money within 30 days of, if you approve this today. In addition, following that expenditure of $5.3 million, the city of Cumming will also pay us the balance of every dollar they receive from the SPLOS 6 tax until SPLOS 6 ends, which I believe is at the end of June of this year. So they'll pay us basically the rest of their SPLOS funds. Now, we then have to pay them dollar for dollar back for however much that is, and I think we've estimated it could be as much as $500,000. David, you'll have to check me on that, but maybe about $500,000. And you may wonder why we're doing that, because those SPLOS funds are dedicated use funds we can then use for the parking deck, and then we'll be giving them different funds, maybe park and rec funds, maybe not, and we'll talk about that in a little bit, but that's a way that both entities or both agencies can then use dedicated earmark funds for projects they need, which is why we're doing that. The IGA further provides that with respect to the parking facilities, the county will be building two. We'll be building one directly outside of this administration building, and we'll be building one on what we're calling the Castleberry parcel, which is over next to Tyson's. Right now it's sort of a parking lot, but soon it'll be a parking garage or parking facility. The IGA contains various language about the use and access to the parking facilities. For instance, during the term that we're constructing the Castleberry lot, that property will be leased to the county, because that's going to put it in our sole ownership and dominion and control, which we'll need for our construction. But as soon as the construction is over, that lease expires, and then we can, quite frankly, will convey title to that facility, the Castleberry facility only, to the city, which means they'll be on the hook for operation and maintenance of that facility, and of course it has to be open for public access, meaning city and county citizen access on equal terms, very much like the Aquatic Center, which is open to the city and county citizens on equal terms. Just a couple of things. The parking facility at the Castleberry location will be open for vehicular use and access from 7 a.m. to 5 p.m. Monday through Friday, and no Forsyth County government vehicles may be charged for overnight parking. The facility is free to the public during business hours. However, the city, once they have ownership of it, which will be at the end of construction, may charge for special events. Okay. With respect to our obligations under this IGA, while the city is going to pay us $5.3 million, we will then pay the city $4 million. All right, we're going to pay the $4 million out of a yet-to-be-decided fund of the county, and I think Mr. Gruen and I may talk to you about that in our next agenda item, quite frankly, so I don't have to talk to you about it right now. But we'll pay the city $4 million within 30 days of this IGA. That money will then be used by the city for infrastructure improvements at city parks. Again, those infrastructure improvements have to be for the common use and access of county and city citizens, as you would expect they would be, and that's the way they're used right now. Additional obligations of the parties under this agreement. with respect to Mason Street, which is the road directly to our left as well. The city is going to abandon Mason Street from a point really about maybe 75 yards into Mason Street to the back of, was that School Street? They will abandon that, and of course that will then become county property because we own both sides of the roadway, and then that'll be our property, and then we can build our parking deck directly on top of what is now Mason Street. As part of our construction of this parking facility next to the administration building, we are also agreeing that we will do some School Street improvements. We will make sure that School Street is two-laned between Pilgrim Mill and Dahlonega Highway, and we will also place a pedestrian sidewalk on the southern boundary of School Street. With respect to the Mason Street portion that is not abandoned, which is immediately off of the state route right here, that will be basically our parking garage's main entrance point. And so we will improve the way that roadway looks because that's going to be the main access point to our parking facility. The city agrees to donate to the county any necessary temporary construction easements for upgrading and improving this unabandoned portion of Mason Street. That's the moving parts of this IGA. As I mentioned, the city of Cumming has already approved it. You may ask, what were the changes from the last version? The biggest changes were, I thought the language in section 2 about that dollar for dollar payment or exchange was a little cumbersome or clunky the way the city had modified it, and I'm not casting blame, I'm just saying it was a little clunky, and so we got it worked out better. So that is, it's very clear now what's going to happen, that there's going to be this reciprocal clunky trying to address an audience. It was not as clear.
They can't say address the commissioner, she said the audience.
So I know who, you know, very clear to me. It's very clear to me that within 30 days of this IGA, there'll be an exchange of 5.3 to the county and 4 million to the city, and then there'll be that dollar for dollar exchange until SPLOS runs out. That is very clear, and I'm very comfortable with that. The only other issue of significance at all was, you remember we got into a little bit of a, at least a discussion about the configuration of the parking facility on the Castleberry, who exactly gets the final say and where exactly it goes. And the city, and we, what the language we worked out was, is it's going to go where our architect says it's going to go with approval of the city administrator. And I think Mr. Dare is generally comfortable with that one.
Yes. Basically, it's the same agreement we sent over and voted 4-0 to send over, except for some wording.
Less clunky.
It's less clunky.
Less clunky. Any questions on the board? Do we hear a motion?
I move that we approve the intergovernmental agreement, City of Cumming, involving the parking deck funds and the improvements to City Park funds as proposed by our county attorney.
And in your agenda book.
And in our agenda book.
Thank you, sir.
Second. We have a motion and a second for the approval of the IGA from South County and City of Cumming. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries 4-0. Item 19 was added by our counselor, Park and Rec Bond Fund.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, I just want to talk to you very briefly about, and sort of kind of bootstrapped into the last discussion, particularly with respect to the $4 million. With respect to the $4 million, Mr. Gruen and I were speaking this afternoon about where exactly that $4 million would come from. And it led us into a discussion about our Park and Rec bond and how those expenditures have gone thus far. Of course, you may recall that prior to the referendum, we had introduced to the citizens a certain list of projects and even funding amounts. And so Mr. Gruen and I were going through those projects and funding amounts. And you know, you, of course, you have authorized sort of the drawdown of the last $17 million of the Park and Green Space bond to sort of complete and finish our obligations to the voters with respect to the projects. The bond law anticipates that in the course of paying for the projects that you've told the voters that you would fund, that circumstances may arise where projects that may have seemed feasible 4 years or 5 years ago are no longer feasible. But there's a process by which you have to go through if you want to change the use. And I'm not recommending that we change any use, but I want to bring an issue to your attention, because I think of the list of projects, and David, check me on this, I think there's around four projects that we have not either fully completed or have fully underway, and I believe they are the Etowah Blueway, there is the Joint Venture Park, there's two more, and I want to
make the Greenway,
the completion of the Greenway extension,
and the
Sawnee Mountain
Phase 3, right. Yes.
Phase 3 Park.
And of those, all of them, as I understand it, are very doable, except, and again, I don't want to speak out of turn here, but my understanding is there may be some problems on the Joint Venture Park. And if we are not going to do a Joint Venture Park, and I don't mean to suggest we are, if you tell me that's where we're going, then that's great. But I just needed clarity on that, because if we're not going to do a joint venture with the Board of Education, there is a protocol we have to follow to not do that.
Are you talking about the Chastity and the right. Wallace Tatum?
Well, the possibility of a joint venture anywhere.
Well, that's exactly why I'm bringing it to you. I'm not sure what the current thought process is. I just remember that when we initially began to approach about a joint venture with one of the schools, and I forget the schools, it got
two. It was Liberty.
And Liberty is what I remember.
And because I was on Park and Rec Board then, and we met with you.
Yeah.
Because we had a big group, or several people from ASCOT. That did not, and they brought George Butler in as their attorney.
Yep.
And they did not want, they said the horses couldn't breed if we lit the field.
And the light, it was the lighting.
Yes.
Yes.
And so you made the determination then with what I heard was that the money needed to stay in the community. And because we had bought Wallace Tatum property, or Matt Community Park, and the Lanier land facility, that both those parks would stay in the community, and that 7.9, I think, is what's in the budget.
It was 7.9.
That it would be just divided between. So we have done construction, or we have done design plans, and they are figuring phase one at each of those parks to use that money.
Okay. Do we anticipate that that will use the entire 7.9 million? The reason I'm asking is because we were looking for places to pull this four million dollars for the city of Cumming, because if they're going to use it for active park and rec purposes, and we have active park and rec money available, it would make sense to use that.
So and the 17 million left for that, well, we've got 7.4.
That's 7.9. Wasn't there lake? Wasn't there two different funds for the lake? Lake parks, didn't we have something in SPLOS, and then we had something?
SPLOS.
Was it all SPLOS?
SPLOS for lake parks.
But I didn't think we were specific on that had to come out of bond.
No, we're not. We're not at all. But again, just goes back to sort of the discussion, though. If we can satisfy that using specific purpose dollars, that's where we'd probably like to be, I think.
But so out of the 17 million, if almost 8 million, is for joint venture, what's the rest of the nine?
Yeah. Sawnee Mountain.
Yeah, Sawnee Mountain.
Greenway.
And the Greenway.
The Blueway.
And the Etowah Blueway is the remaining million we have left from the original money. Mm-hmm. What will happen is, and we're, I think Ken, where Ken's going with this, is that if these four areas are finished as funded, what we'll be left with is $3 million unspent from the green space line, the $36 million, we spent $33. And there'll be up to about $1 million, perhaps, in other savings. Part of that million already is in other savings. That's where we're looking to see at some point where the board will act to use the $4 million. Right. But it will depend on, I think where Ken's going, is completing these other projects as previously listed, and the change in the joint venture.
The Etowah has funded. Been designed. I mean, it has been, I think
right.
That money
there's $1 million toward that in there now. Mm-hmm.
No, that's it. I mean, that's exactly. So I'm sort of just looking for money, but I wanted to make sure that I understood on any of these items we weren't sure about that I got some certainty on. And if there's, you know, we may have to just simply fund it from general fund and then pay it back if there's money left at the end of the parking. And we have every right to do that. We can do that.
Well, right now, basically, if we
agree to this, we're going to what, exchange checks in 30 days, we have to get out of general funds, wouldn't we?
That's correct.
And then reimburse it anyway.
Yes. And that's sort of where Mr. Gruen and I ended today as well, just because of the timing.
When are the bond funds available to us?
They'll be available May 1st.
Well, we're close.
Do we need to take any action as council, or just for information purposes?
Actually, there's no need for any action. I know what I need to do.
Let me ask the board this question, if you don't mind. We had discussed with the board before bringing forward an updated spreadsheet, if you will, with all the projects. Put that in front of you and let you ask you to prioritize, make some decisions about the projects in total. That will probably give you a much better idea of what projects are out there, which ones have been completed, are there funds, is there a balance left over, if you will, from some of those projects, and that might help you decide and prioritize what projects you want to do with the remaining $17 million and the balance of the $83 million. We can bring that to you at the next work session.
That's a good idea, because some of these projects have a phase two and phase three to them that we really haven't talked about.
That's right.
We can bring that to the next work session.
Because what we'll do now is we'll take that column that said $83 million in amended budget, we'll now bring that back up to the full $100 million.
And you'll know exactly how much is left from that original.
Right. You'll see each line.
Thank you, Dave.
Should we take it a step farther and look at the other projects that we have ongoing with Park and Rec as far as with impact fees and SPLOST 6? And
we have that document as well.
I mean, because it could be that, I don't know if we can use, I mean, I'm sure that there, since it is Park and Rec, there'd be a way of making adjustments.
So that'd be, y'all present that too?
Yeah.
Same time?
Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions? Thank you. David, Councilor. Councilor, do we need an executive session?
We do, Mr. Chairman.
I didn't get to finish my sentence.
Sorry.
You can ask me why I don't finish it. To discuss litigation, land acquisition, and our personnel?
Yes, sir.
Okay, better. Is that a motion to recess the work session and convene into executive session to for the purpose of litigation, land acquisition, and our personnel.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? We will reconvene at 3:30.
It's good to see you back. Missed you at the commissioners meeting, you know, on Thursday.
I've missed it too. I enjoyed going.
Well, it's good to see you back.
Yeah. The first thing I want to say is whatever happened, I mean, this 2 years, we need to